This is Valdivia in 1960, the largest earthquake ever recorded in the history with a magnitude of 9.4 to 9.6. This is Alaskan earthquake, 1964, the second largest. And this, the third largest and the deadliest earthquake and tsunami that hit the Indian Ocean, which had around 200,000 fatalities. We have been studying earthquakes for quite some time. In fact, we have data from recent earthquakes, and we also have it even from hundreds of years back in the history. 1556, Shaanxi, China recorded the deadliest earthquake ever in the history with more than 800,000 casualties. We have been doing lots of research, collecting data, and trying to understand how earthquakes behave, but nature never fails to surprise us. Even now, recently, we have discovered the first occurrence of a very rare geological phenomena called a boomerang earthquake. Well, we don't want to take much of your time, so let's directly dive in and see how earthquakes happen, how it is studied, and some of all that you need to know about earthquakes. Meanwhile, don't forget to subscribe to DNA for more interesting videos like this. We post a video every week, and also don't forget to comment below your feedback and topics that you might be interested to see. Our Earth is made of four major layers: the inner core, outer core, mantle, and crust. The crust is where the cities, mountains, rivers, and oceans are there. Mantle is the molten part. The crust is just 1% of Earth's total volume. At the oceans, crust is usually 5 to 10 kilometers thick, and on land, they are like 30 to 50 kilometers thick. And also, crust is not just one single layer. Instead, it is like multiple puzzle pieces put together. These puzzle pieces are called the tectonic plates. There are majorly 7 tectonic plates, like the 7 continents, and further divided into dozens of other smaller plates. These tectonic plates on mantle is like plastic sheets on water. They're just constantly floating and moving. But they're usually attached or touching on the edges. The plates are moving all the time, and there is a lot of energy stored up in the edges of these plates, called the plate boundaries. When one plate has moved far enough and its edge gets detached or unstick from the other edge, all that stored up energy gets released, and that energy release causes earthquake. The point where this energy is released is called the hypocenter, and the location right above it on the Earth's surface is called the epicenter. When the plates are detached at the boundaries, they usually move in three different ways. One, the divergent boundaries, plates that are moving away from each other. This could cause rifts or valleys, which paves way for water bodies like rivers and oceans to flow through, which could form new water bodies. Number two, convergent boundaries. When two tectonic plates slide over each other and may form new geological structures such as mountains. Number three, transform boundary. When the plate boundaries slide past each other, like in case of San Andreas Fault in California. Recently, we even found the first evidence on record for the occurrence of a boomerang earthquake, where the plates first move away from each other and then slide over one another back, like a boomerang. Nature is full of surprises. Usually, earthquakes occur in three stages: foreshocks, which cause smaller earthquakes, and then comes the main shock, which is the main phase of the earthquake, and then the aftershocks, which follows the main shock. These aftershocks could be felt for hours, weeks, even months after the main shock. Now, the big question might be, if it is just the release of stored up energy, why the Earth itself is shaking? Well, when there is release of energy, we are talking about a tremendous amount of energy. They are released as seismic waves, like a ripple in the pond. When these waves pass through the Earth's surface, they shake the Earth. When the hypocenter is near the surface of the Earth, it causes devastating earthquakes, and when they are away from the Earth's surface, they are less intense. We know that the study of these seismic waves is called seismography, and the recordings are called as seismograms. These recordings are graphical and has two different waves, P waves and S waves. P waves are like stretch and squash waves, where the Earth's surface itself stretches and squashes. S waves are like actual waveforms displacing and moving the Earth's surface up and down. Scientists use these P and S waves even for finding the exact location of the earthquakes. How do they find it? Well, we need to understand that P waves travel faster than the S waves. It is like lightning and thunder. P waves lead and S waves follow. Usually, scientists use triangulation technique to find the precise location. Here, we have three seismometers, and each one has calculated the distance. Now, the intersecting point of all the three seismometers' calculated distance would be the exact location of the earthquake. Actually, earthquakes occur a lot more on Earth's surface. But since most of them are minor and smaller earthquakes, we don't really feel it. Earthquakes with magnitude less than 2 are not usually felt. Magnitude of 2 to 4 has minor vibrations, and 4 to 7 are moderate and could cause some damage, and anything more than 7 are highly severe, intense, and are major earthquakes. One thing to be noted when it comes to magnitude is that it is calculated from 0 to 10 in Richter scale. They are not linear, instead they are logarithmic, which means an earthquake of magnitude 5 is 10 times more intense than the one of magnitude 4. If we compare two earthquakes of magnitude 7 and 4, then magnitude 7 earthquake would be 1000 times stronger than the other. There are a few ways where we can actually detect earthquake. One such way is when the Earth's surface emits radioactive gases into the air before earthquakes. This happens usually 5 to 10 days before earthquake. Even though we have instruments and studies to research on earthquake, still we are not able to find any method to predict the earthquakes precisely way before occurring. Nature is always one step ahead of us. Hope you find the video useful. If you do like this video, please like, share, and subscribe to DNA. And please let us know your feedback on the comment section down below. Also, we welcome your suggestions of what you would like to see in our next video. Until then, see you guys.